ラウンテーブル4のテーマは健康と安全。
The theme of Roundtable 4
チェアは早稲田大学高等研究所所長、
Health、
社会科学総合学術主任教授の赤尾健一先生です。
The session will be chaired
それでは赤尾先生、どうぞよろしくお願いいたします。
By Professor 赤尾、Director of WOYAS and Professor of Faculty of Social Sciences at 早稲田 University。
So good afternoon, everyone. Let's get started. Roundtable 4. Title is Health and Security. My name is Ken Akao. I'm a director of WOYAS and the chair of this session. In this session, we have four excellent speakers. The first speaker is Professor Takuya Soma-sensei.From the Hakubi Project at Kyoto University. He is an alumnus of WOYAS. His specialty is geography. The second speaker is Dr. Yudis Dematagota-san. He is an assistant professor at WOYAS. His specialty is ideological aesthetic. Am I right? Okay.Thank you. and the third speaker is Dr. Ariane Bertuk from Zukunft College at the University of Konstanz. And she participates in this session through the Zoom. She's a postdoctoral fellow, and her specialty is sociology. The first speaker is Dr. Yasutaka Kakui-sensei, an assistant professor at WOYAS. He is a molecular biologist. Now, each speaker will talk for 10 minutes. Then we will have a discussion session for 20 minutes. And in the discussion session, we will have some questions from the floor. Soma-sensei, please start your talk.
Akosa-sensei, thank you for your introduction. Also, thank you very much for introduction. I'm very much honored to be a part of this very great symposium for 15 years of bias. So let me share my slide now. So today I'm going to talk about a little bit different story about like human-animal well-being from the steppe Silk Road, because I define myself as a geographer and at the same time I'm a field scientist. But yesterday we also talked about the methodologies. So I a little bit talk more about my subjective experiences in my field in Silk Road countries because sometimes I also researching about very qualitative data collection and analysis, but I also feel really difficult to get reach to the very, very substantial meaning of culture and society. So let me go through what is the Silk Road. That the Silk Road is a very great place. There's so many mountains and also at the same time the desert place and a beautiful lake and water place and also a steppe land. Then I am very much committed into now in Tianshan Mountain in Kyrgyzstan, and that place is the coexistence of agricultural field, and also at the same time there's a animal husbandry places for century lasting culture there. So, but beforehand, thanks for the last session that the Shu Sensei also talked about the Ukraine crisis. Then I just months before I visited Kyrgyz, there's so many Russian young guys. In Kyrgyzstan, so I also feel very much difficult to find even hotels and restaurants. Then this is a photograph when I talk in Bishkek town. Then normally there's so many Kyrgyz people enjoying dinners, but nowadays there's so many Russians evacuated from Russia or some mobilization by President Putin. So if I talk about the first in the conclusions, then in the Silk Road countries, it's that place is really, really far away from the healthy and also security from the very much historical times. So that's why in nowadays, even nowadays, the Silk Road is a very, very unstable places, even in not only politics, but also like a human conflict as well. So I am going to talk a little bit about very interesting data. I found the archaeological data from 2005 years ago. There's a funeral mound in Xinjiang Autonomous. At the time that the deceased, the buried people, the average age is about 25 to 35 years old. I also looking for the Mongolian herders, and that their longevity, not really longevity, like a life expectancy, is not so long even in nowadays. So what do you think about if you finish your life about 25 or 30 years old? So that is quite implicative to endorse how the herders are facing very difficult situations in steppe-run territories. You can see that the pictures, there's several natural disasters always happens in Mongolia and also Central Eurasian place, and then many livestock died, and also not only livestock but also the human also dies unfortunately by this kind of natural disaster. So, and also this is my house where I was living with Kazakh nomadic people for 400 days in Altai Mountain. So, and also that was really, really, the life is very cruel because of that steppe-land environment really very much severely changed in between summer and winter. So that's why I also feel that the sudden end of life, such kind of lifestyle foster the peculiar view of transience and also apocalypse in the nomadic mind. So when I stayed with nomadic family and living in the Altai Mountains, I also very much get attached with my animals where I live together, because animals always feeling, hearing my mind. And also last session, the Kasai Sensei also talked about that the well-being is cannot achieved only isolated situations. Maybe we can also connect with animals, neighbors, and also not only such kind of people and animals, but also environment together. So let me go through that my researches in Silk Road briefly. So the animals is a of course, the dog is a very, very great buddy for the herders. And also from the 2,000 years ago, that the dog is quite greatly engaged in the hunting area, hunting by people in Silk Road countries like this. And also that horses are very, very great that entity in the nomadic societies. And also even nowadays, the Kyrgyz people are very, very great horse riders, and also even and ladies and small girls also committed into the such kind of like a great horse riding techniques. And also, I also very much surprised that like nomadic people, like Mongolian people, has more than 400 horse color types. So it's really, really great native local knowledges. They recognize so many colors in domesticated horses. And also the camels as well. So that in one part in Gobi Desert in southern Mongolia, people once the ladies get to deliver their babies on the camel backs, and also sometimes the funeral ceremony is also done on the top of the camel back. So that's why the camel always always assigned to the camel riders in desert area. My first career is very much dedicated to researching about the golden eagle. The golden eagle is a very, very special kind of animals. They train them to the huntings, but not only huntings, but also it was very, very greatly engaged their spiritual world, because sometimes the golden eagle are used for the cure of like a mental illness, or sometimes they bring golden eagle to the delivery of the ladies. So it was created so deep kind of spiritual world together. And also wolves is one of the like a kind of like creation. It's really engaged to the kind of ethnogenesis of nomadic people, like Mongolian people and Kyrgyz people and Kazakh people think themselves as a descendant of wolves. So this picture is, I'm quite lucky, the last January I joined the wolf hunting. The wolves is now increasing in Silk Road country. So they bring so much like a livestock predatory on the herder society, but not only such kind of predatory, but also that the nomadic people very much respect their entity as well. So, and also this, I also now dedicated to studying about the snow leopard. Snow leopard is now about 3,500 to 4,000 individuals there, but the still endangered animal. But this picture is taken by my trap camera in Kenshan Mountains. And also not only the herders very much respect these animals, but unfortunately even still nowadays the poaching is happens in Kyrgyz and also Mongolian territory. So, and also the ones the hunters hunt snow leopard, they conduct snow leopard funeral in that places. So I actually studying about wild animals and wildlife is for 18 years in Silk Road, but I never ever heard of such kind of ceremonies except snow leopard. And also, so I'm going to conclude that that the last session is very much implicated for me because that the well-being is not only we cannot achieve only isolated situation. When I live together with nomadic people, the well-being need to be well finally achieved with connection to the not only people, neighbors, but also animals, and also. Well, okay, and also not only animals, but also historical knowledges from descendant or from ancestors from the nomadic community as well. So,
the well-being is not just brought from isolation.
So, thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you very much, Somo Sensei. Very, very fascinating talk and very beautiful pictures which shows harmonization relationship between the animals and wildlife and the human beings. Although the situation is not only beautiful, but also it's harsh and severe. But thank you very much. So now I would like to introduce the second speaker. Demataku Das Sensei, please start your talk.
So I'd like to begin by thanking everybody at VS, directors Professor Akaro, Professor Yamamoto, Professor Takura, and of course the former director Professor Aramura, and all of the staff at VS, Iwaki-san, in particular Marubayashi-san, Suda-san, Kawasuzaki-san, Kimura-san, and all of the others provide us with so much support and help. So as I'm coming to the end of my time here at VS, I've come to realize the unique value of institutes that are still able to provide academics with an opportunity to engage with what was, and I think always has been, an important precondition for scholarly activity and obviously well-being in general, which is to have a love of knowledge and contemplation. So I think it's an incredibly important thing to remember, particularly in the last 2 years when frustration and isolation during the pandemic, it was always important to remember the kind of heart of everything that we do is to some extent related to these notions, to have a love of knowledge. So what I'll do is just kind of describe how my research kind of relates to that to some extent. I'll start by briefly describing some of the research I've been working on for the past 2 years and then talk about a new and interesting direction this research has taken as a result of the time I've had at VS to contemplate my topic in my office alone. So I'm a modernist literature scholar. I specialize in 20th century modernist literature, mostly in English, but also in French and German as well, to some extent, and also theories of literary criticism and the avant-garde. My first book was on the Russian-American novelist Vladimir Nabokov and the relationship between politics and aesthetics in his work. And I just finished writing at VS my second book on the relationship between fascism, masculinity, and technology in the modernist period, and what it can tell us about what is occurring in the present. So all of this research and what I'm going to talk about today is related to the concept I've been developing since my PhD, which is known as the ideological aesthetic. And this is a kind of still speculative notion which concerns the kind of fundamental phenomenological, sort of related to perception, problematic related to the notion of perception and consciousness, and the way that we mediate between individuals and their material conditions. So it's a kind of theory that synthesizes these two ideas, which were distinct, the notion of ideology, political ideology, but also other forms of ideology, and the notion of the aesthetic, which is our kind of conception of what is beautiful, but not necessarily within the kind of classical terms. This is a problematic which was taken up by the French philosopher Louis Althusser in his very brief Letter on Art, but in my opinion was ultimately deferred and left unresolved. So in my theoretical work, I bring together these three facets together in sort of various perspectives to kind of come up with sort of a theory of the ideological aesthetic. And during my time at VS, I will be publishing, there will be forthcoming in early 2023, in May, in the journal Angelaki, an article which I've offered with a co-author, Christos Asamatos, an art historian, called The Ideological Aesthetic, The Political as Inevitable and Epiphenomenal. And it was due to the time I've been given at VS to contemplate and refine this concept that I've been able to achieve this publication. And it's a very kind of surreal achievement for me as an undergraduate, when I used to read with great confusion articles in this journal by philosophers such as Derrida or Rancière or Alain Badiou or Slavoj Žižek. And I will actually now be having a publication in this journal myself, so I'm very happy to have that opportunity. Another kind of output is the network I've established, the Ideology and Aesthetics Research Network. We have a public lecture series, which we publish on YouTube, which you should definitely check out. So yeah, I'm just gonna move on to what is the new direction of this kind of project related to ideology and aesthetics. So it's the use of data science, big data, and algorithms, and a kind of practice which has been around perhaps about 10 years, using computational methods to analyze large volumes of text, and it's called distant reading, after a book which was written by Franco Moretti in 2013. Now, it's the use of data-driven algorithms to analyze large volumes of literary text, and the way I'm going to use this, as I'm using it with my collaborator, a computer scientist, is to look for patterns within what I define as a global and interconnected modernist aesthetic. So what are modernist aesthetics? According to the sociologist Pierre Bourdieu, modernism was the institutionalization of anomie. And that's a bit of a mouthful. So what does anomie mean? Anomie is a concept which was first coined by the sociologist Emile Durkheim in his 1897 work, The Phenomenon of, on the Phenomenon of Suicide. So it's something that might be familiar to a lot of people that live in kind of advanced, kind of technologically advanced societies, like Japan, for example. So when a social system is in a state of anomie, common values and meanings are no longer understood or accepted, and new values and meanings have not developed. So according to Durkheim, such societies produce, in many of his members, psychological states which are characterized by a sense of futility, uselessness, a lack of purpose, emotional emptiness, and despair. So striving, you know, working towards something is considered useless because there's no accepted definition of what is desirable. Now, as Bourdieu's kind of his kind of conceptualization, his theory that modernism is the kind of institutionalization of this phenomenon in art, in popular aesthetics, in painting, in literature, in theater, in architecture, for example. So this is a kind of interesting theory, but I think it needs updating. Because, I mean, before kind of I'll present some of the concrete aims of the project that I'm kind of dealing with, we kind of touch upon this idea a little bit. I think it does not acknowledge the kind of unevenly experienced process of technological modernization throughout the world, and that it kind of precludes a properly global theory of what modernism is. So my project will instead begin with this hypothesis that modernism is instead an immanent and ambient aesthetic mode that is apparent across different literary, cultural, temporal, and geographical boundaries. And to test this, I'm going to identify elements of this global modernist aesthetic and use these kind of novel data-driven computational methods to analyze large volumes of texts in different languages, hopefully, and then to kind of develop a sort of theory. So what I'm kind of developing is this idea that the anime of modernism is related to this notion of the void, but this precludes, this isn't necessarily modern, it is necessarily European, and it kind of goes beyond, much beyond that. We could go back 2,000 years, the philosophy of the very famous Buddhist philosopher Nagarjuna, the first century Indian philosopher, who begins his doctrine, his fundamental wisdom of the middle path, with this quote: no origin, no extinction, no permanence, nor impermanence, no identity, nor difference, no arrival, nor departure. So we see this also in the philosophy of Pyrrho and Pyrrhonism and Greek antiquity, in this concept of atarachia, which describes a state of tranquility and equanimity related to this idea of negation and the void. Pyrrho, in his turn, was influenced by the Gymnosophists in India, where he studied when he came to India as part of Alexander the Great's invading armies, for example. So these connections all over the world that we can look at, and it's a daunting task for traditional literary scholarship, but using these kind of new methods, which literary scholars are kind of suspicious of, we're able to kind of synthesize and examine the global connections that exist for these patterns. And that's the end of my discussion. If you'd like to, again, contact with me, please write to me on this email address. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Dr. Deman Gota-sensei. Thank you for the very, very philosophical talk. You introduced the Nagarjuna. I remember the book is very, very hard to understand, and I finally give up reading it. Anyway, thank you very much. And now that we will, I would like to introduce the third speaker, Dr. Belot Petrok from Tsukumto College at University Constance. Could you start the presentation?
Yes, good afternoon. Dear colleagues, dear organizers, dear Akala-sensei, have many thanks for inviting me and for letting me join online. It's still very dark and very cold and very snowy here in Switzerland from where I'm joining, but I'm happy to be here nevertheless. It's a great honor to have the opportunity to present some ongoing work. And of course, I'm also curious of what you think about it. So let me just start sharing my slides, so that you can see in full screen mode what I'm going to talk about. So there we go. Now you should be able to see the full screen mode of my slides as well. So I'm going to talk about a research project that I do together with my colleague Anja Leist in Luxembourg. And we are a joint venture of a sociologist and an epidemiologist who are concerned with cognitive aging. Now, what do we mean by cognitive aging? We do mean the fact that people lose their cognitive abilities in the second half of life along the way that they age. And this is a very relevant topic because against the backdrop of demographic change and population aging, a number of health challenges arise that are costly for both individuals that are concerned with these health challenges, but also societies that have to somehow organize and provide healthcare services and care. And I think dementia and cognitive decline are particularly interesting examples because they are still not curable. So we're still not having a medical cure against dementia. However, what we know is that there are a number of preventive and also modifiable factors along the life course that kind of occur earlier that we can investigate and that we can also use to create targeted interventions to have people have better cognitive states later in life. And cognitive decline has been shown to be an excellent predictor of later life dementia risks. Now, the recent years have seen a growing influence in a growing interest in the research on social influence or social factors that can promote cognitive health and cognitive abilities in later life. So I just listed a number of them, and I would like to especially highlight that being working and having an occupation that's cognitively stimulating is really important, but also the societal context with its policies and its cultural norms and even the economic well-being of a society can really create opportunities for accumulating cognitive reserve along the life course. And of course, also gender and family roles play a role. So it has been shown that, for instance, people who are able to have multiple roles tend to benefit from these roles because this too can be cognitively stimulating and showing better levels of cognitive functioning later in life. So in this very study that I'm going to present, we take a life course approach. We're studying cognitive health differentials between people with different previous life courses. So we're looking back to the time when they were younger and fully engaged in the labor markets and see how their cognitive functioning looks later in life. And we're especially interested in gender norms as one of the contextual determinants of such cognitive trajectories. So what we're doing here is we're comparing individuals from 20 countries from 5 birth cohorts, and we observe them over a time span of up to 13 years. So we have ample variation in our data, which is really great. So the research questions that we're trying to tackle in this paper are just on the one hand, how gender norms are associated with cognitive functioning, then what is the role of previous employment biographies, and finally, whether the returns from different but employment biographies might be varying according to the gender norms being held in the respective context. So let me jump right into the finding. If you're interested in the data and the modeling and statistical particularities, you see this little box on the right-hand side that describes a little bit what we actually did with all the data. So in this first panel, you can see the correlation between cognitive functioning that is depicted on the vertical axis and the gender norms being held that is depicted on the horizontal axis. And we see a strong negative correlation indicating that the stricter the gender norms in a context, the less well the cognitive functioning of the elderly population in that respective context. Now, this holds for both men and women, and this also holds for different indicators of social norms. Next, we look at the role of previous employment biographies. And here we actually calculated how much time individuals had been spending in different states of work or non-work between the times or between the ages of 20 to 50. Now, full-time employment is still the most common state that both men and women have spent in. So this is serving as the reference category, which is why you will not see a coefficient estimate for full-time employment. Now, how to read this graph? If you have an estimate on the left-hand side of the dashed line, that means that it's a negative effect. So it indicates lower cognitive functioning. If you have an estimate on the right-hand side of the dashed line, it indicates a positive association or a positive effect, indicating that people have a higher cognitive functioning. Now, we see that for men, the previous employment biography doesn't tend to be very much correlated with cognitive functioning because most of the coefficient estimates are actually non-significant. You also see the large confidence intervals. But for women, we have this really interesting finding that if they work more part-time, they have better cognitive functioning. And if they were more a homemaker, meaning only caring for the family but not working, they tend to have less cognitive functioning. Finally, the last question, whether these cognitive returns from previous employment might be mattering according to normative context. And here I would especially like to focus on the role of part-time employment, which I find extremely interesting and which is also something that has really been on the rise in Europe in many countries, being celebrated as some sort of a new form of work-life balance and also having received quite some policy support. So we see that for men, there is a slight part-time benefit. Men who work part-time have a little bit higher cognitive levels, but only in contexts that are quite egalitarian, as is indicated by this black circle on the left-hand side. For the rest, as we've seen before, previous employment biographies don't really seem to matter. We have all these like big spikes and big confidence intervals indicating no significance. For the women, on the other hand, on the right-hand side, we see also a black circle indicating that women are also better off if they work more part-time, just duplicating the finding from before. But this especially holds in contexts where the gender norms are more traditional, so where we go more to the right-hand side. Now, let me draw some conclusion from that. So, revisiting our research questions, are gender norms associated with cognitive functioning? Yes, we do find that more traditional gender norms are associated with lower cognitive functioning in later life, and this holds for both genders. So, if we want to translate that into real world or real life, we could say that no one really benefits from strict gender norms. So it's detrimental for the cognitive functioning for both genders. So not even men have an advantage. With regard to the role of previous work, we find that part-time work or part-time employment seems to be protective. However, that only holds for women overall. And it has been argued that because work is cognitively stimulating, but because people have these multiple roles of being engaged in the family and in the work domain, that this might actually be a booster or a benefit for cognitive functioning in later life. So this is in line with the literature, and generally can say for women that being in work is better than being in non-work in terms of cognitive functioning in later life. Now, the final question, whether we have different cognitive returns in contexts with different norms. And here, too, we can say yes. So we found that especially part-time work seems to be mediated by the context. So part-time work is only protective when it's also normatively accepted. Now, how is that so? Let me give you an example. We found that for men, previous part-time employment was positive, but only in gender egalitarian context, which is context that might also support men being more involved in the domain of the family. And for women, it was exactly the other way around. So here we found that part-time employment was particularly beneficial in more traditional contexts, which also promote the woman's role in the family. Now, this study has a number of implications, because if we're thinking about work-life balance as having lifelong consequences, we need to extend that thinking into cognitive abilities in later life, which are extremely important for instance, living independently or being still part of the society and social life. This study also has a number of limitations because the mechanisms are still extremely hard to test, because we cannot go turn back in time and test people's cognitive abilities when they were 20, 30, 40, etc. So we actually don't know. We just have to infer from the literature. And finally, we think that we should continue this type of research and look whether maybe also work and family policies are somehow related to these gender norms and might also play a role there. So this is something that is testable. And with that, I would like to conclude and thank you for your attention.
Thank you very much, Dr. Appelrod. Your analysis is very, very solid, and the result is interesting and has a very, very potentially significant policy implications. Thank you very much. Now, I would like to introduce the last speaker, Kakui Sensei. Could you start your presentation?
Thank you very much for introducing me. I'm Yasuo Kakui, assistant professor here at YS. First of all, I'd like to thank the organizer to give me this great opportunity to talk in this great session. So I'm a cell biologist and study the inheritance of genetic information through the generation. In this session, my talk will focus on well-being and health in the view of cell biologists. So what I will talk about is well-being for cells, not for humans, not for human behavior. So which is not usually thinking of the others. So let's get started. So let me start my presentation to think of the relationship between health and well-being. According to the WHO statement, health is a state of complete physical, mental, and social well-being, and not merely the absence of disease or infirmity. So there are three well-beings, social, mental, and physical well-beings, to be healthy. So these three well-beings are highly related to each other, like this schematics. But I think these well-beings are kind of have a hierarchies. So I think so this well-being should be like this. Social well-being is should be on top of the mental well-being, because if you have unwellness in your mental health, you cannot involved in the society. So social well-being means that it's usually defined by the active engagement to your society or to your community. So social well-being, social well-being should be on top of that. And the second layer is mental well-being. So if you feel unwellness, you have more like a feeling mental unwellness, such as like depression or anxiety. So in that case, you can. Body doesn't work very well without nice physical well-being, your mental is kind of like unwell. So. And therefore, the bottom layer of this well-being should be physical well-being. So I'd like to dig on the physical well-being further to the next slide. So as I mentioned, physical well-being is a key element of quality of your life. So here is a list of the behavior that you have of physical well-being. So you should sleep well, eat well, and be physically active, and have good hygiene, and get enough relaxation or carry out social roles. So this is a component of physical well-being. So to achieve these physical well-being, your body should have a good state. So I think to be a good physical well-being, there is a three main component for that. First, if you don't have any symptom of disease, if you have any disease, you feel like you cannot eat well or you cannot get enough relaxation. And the second one is no physical limitation. So if you have a difficulty to move, you can not go anywhere you want. It makes you like stressed, and this causes mental unwellness or physical unwellness. And the third one is no pain, no body pain. I think as you experienced a lot, if you have any kind of aches, such as headaches or stomach aches, you cannot sleep well. So to get nice physical well-being, you don't have any disease or any physical limitation or any pain. So what I want to talk about here is that not physical well-being itself. I'm a cell biologist, so I want to talk about well-being for cells. Before moving on to the well-being for cells, I'd like to explain a bit more about our body and cells. So as you may know, our body consists of more than 37 trillion of the cells. This is a quite huge number of cells, and it is like 10,000 times more than the whole population on the Earth. So that's why we sometimes explain our body is a small universe. So in our body, each cell has to maintain its well-being. As you learned in school, cells contain DNA in the nucleus and the other organelles in the cell, such as mitochondria. So each of these components has to be transmitted properly via cell division. So if cells fail to divide properly, like lack of proper amount of DNA or lack of mitochondria, cell well-being for cells is compromised. So our body is coming from only single embryo after fertilization. So once cells has to divide thousands of times until cells build our body. So even in everyday life, this kind of cell division takes place all the time in some kind of cell types. So for example, in gut, entire cells in gut are renewed for 4 days to 2 weeks. Or the same things happen to blood cells or bone cells. In contrast, some neuron cells in brain is one of the cell types that do not divide normally once you become adult. So cell biologists like me dissect our body in this kind of like small level. So for us cell biologists to understand physical well-being, a question we try to answer is what is the well-being for cells? So to think well-being for cells, we should consider factors to impair well-being. As you might know, ultraviolet UV or reactive oxygen species are major source of damage to our body here. And these damage sources actually harm our cells as well. So for example, UV cuts the DNA to get DNA damage, or reactive oxygen species directly harm organelles in the cells. So then what happens to the cells after getting this kind of damage? So it totally depends on the level of damage. If cells get lower level of damage, cells stop dividing and become senescent. And if cells get higher level of damage here, the activity of cells can no longer maintain anymore, and usually result in apoptosis, or these kind of such kind of damaged cells eliminated by your immune systems. And if the cells get intermediate level of damage here, cells start abnormal division, which result in cancer cell formation. So many cell biologists try to understand how cell tolerates and responds to these damages. And the last thing, summarize up. My study is focusing on heredity, and this is a cycle of transmission of the genetic information like this. And what is important for the heredity of the well-beings? So the oocyte is getting older when mother is getting older. So here is a graph that shows that the relationship between maternal age and the incidence of trisomy, such as Down syndrome. As you can spot, over 35 years old, the incidence become dramatically increased a lot. So I'm for studying how this happens using older mouse model system to study this molecular mechanism. So as in certain time, this kind of like maternal age is quite important to solve the issue, because the diversity of our career paths or the gender equality, this fertility treatment is one of the greatest interest in this uncertain era. So thank you. That is all from me. Thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you very much, Kakui-sensei. the microscopic world is very, very interesting and unique compared with other presentations. Now we move on to the discussion part. We have 15 minutes. And the today's subject is life, and life is so various. And the presentation contents also are very, very diverse. So I would like to give a comment and questions to each speakers. And I think the time is quite limited. So before speakers answer to my questions, I would like to ask a follower for the questions and the comments. So let me start. To the Soma-sensei, you questioned how to consider the animal's well-being. This important question leads to the long-lasting criticism to the anthropocentrism in environmental issues. So how do you think about it? My answer is there is two answers, two ways. First, we question such a thing because we have sympathy and empathy, such a living thing. However, this implies that a question arises in our mind. Because of this, we cannot escape from the anthropocentrism. Another answer is, although we should test such a thing equally, living thing, such a thing will not understand the concept of equality due to the difference of the form in the terminology of Wittgenstein. So how do you think about it? This is my question to Soma-sensei. And to Damatagota-sensei, I have a question about your equation, ideology and aesthetic. I'm a quite layman, but in my understanding, aesthetic is a quite individual thing. Also, and in contrast, ideology is a kind of the collective concept. And so we need some transition from individual concept to the collective or social concept. A similar thing structure can be observed for the health problem or secure problem. Health and secure is an individual problem, but it is also a social problem. So the transition, there is something need to explain the transition. In economics, we have to aggregate individuals' well-being or welfare to the social welfare. I think this is the same type of the problem, transition from the individual to social thing. This is my question to the Damatagota-sensei. And Dr. Peltog, your research is very, very interesting and very clear. So my question is quite an oblique one. I think there might be something latent factors, especially the genetic factors, that affect both development of dementia and the preference to conservative thought or something like that. If it exists, do an endogeneity problem emerges or not? This is my question to Betrock-sensei. And lastly, Kakui-sensei, I have no idea about a very, very small world, but my body consists of the numerous number of the cells. And I feel some sickness, then maybe the several cells show some malfunction. Then how many cells, how many cells are damaged, then are we realize, recognize the sick. Maybe the, it's very, very different cases. So the, could you show some example or some rule of thumb, if you can have an answer? Thank you very much. And before answering my question, I would like to ask Flora, if you have a question, please raise your hand. We have 10 minutes. No? Okay, so could you start, please?
Akao-sensei, thank you for your questions. Very, very good questions. I am also thinking, really thinking about the equality between human and animal, because nomadic society, okay, in a sense, well, nomadic people are kind of exploit, well, eat livestock and also hunt quite a lot of wildlife, not only like herbivores, but also something like, marmots and also wildcats. And also even wolves. So I ate wolves once a time in Altai Mountains, and it's not very much delicious, like a taste like sand. So, and all of resources are quite used in the, such kind of like a very, very traditional way of life. So, but on the other hand, the nomadic people and also traditional hunter very much respect local wildlife resources. For example, like a sheep, you can see the sheep in the husbandry area. So if we stop the management of the sheep, sheep never ever can survive in the nature again. So it means the sheep. So it's kind of an evolutionary sense. Sheep need to be managed by human hand, the husbandry. And also like a golden eagle, I saw that the very, very huge bird. The golden eagle was tamed, trained for nearly 4 or 5 years. But after 5 years, the eagle hunters, eagle masters release again to the nature. Then afterward, this is my hypothesis, that the golden eagle survivability will be rising up, because the human train quite a lot for the hunting and also for the something like a dietary something, and also something like they train them to hunt foxes and wolves or even more huge animals. So that's why it's becoming kind of like a something like a coexistence. This is a case study. So this is my idea. So, and also one thing. So the Akao-sensei said that the Anthropocene, Hitoshinsei, Jinshinsei is a very, very great term, but in my opinion, when I living with nomadic people in Altai Mountain, they really, really respect, they really fit themselves to the local environment. So I can also said we also need to think about something like a counter Anthropocene in nowadays. The Anthropocene is a kind of a human-centralized term, but on the other hand, like nomadic people or Kyrgyzstan, Kazakhstan, Mongolia, they really respect their nature, local nature. This is my opinion.
Thank you very much. So please, Dhamma Dugotat-sensei.
Thank you very much for the extremely perceptive question, because you really struck right to the heart of the issue I'm trying to kind of resolve here. So it's a great question, because you identify the aesthetic is based on a kind of subjective perception of the world, and ideology is heretofore a kind of collective theory. Now, the key component here is the philosophy of Louis Althusser, who said that ideology is the imaginary relationship between an individual and his real conditions of existence. The way that he demonstrated this was a very famous example, saying that when a policeman calls into a crowd and says, "Hey, you there," most people think they're calling, they're the one being called, and they turn around instinctively. Now, this is a concept he described as interpolation. And it's a very subjective concept, and it's related also to perception. It's this idea that you are called by ideology, by certain kind of psychological processes, etc., and you're interpolated within the ideology. So it's an individual identification into an ideology. So my theory is that the way that Althusser conceptualized this, he never said it, but he implied it, was already almost identical to the way that he conceived of the aesthetic, which is a kind of departure, I guess, from the kind of traditional Kantian notion.
Thank you very much. And please answer the mic to Dr. Petru.
Yes, I'm going to split up your question into two, because I think there are two different aspects to it. So first, you asked about latent factors, especially genetic factors. And I think this is, again, you struck it to the heart, so to speak, because, of course, there are genetic factors to cognitive aging. However, research shows also that kind of the pure genetic prediction of dementia risk is only about 7 to 12%. Whereas if you look at behavioral factors such as drinking, smoking, doing sports, it's actually more like 40%. So behavioral factors seem to have a higher explanatory potential. However, we should bring them together. We should interact them, epigenetics. And this is something we cannot do with the data at hand because we're simply not having genetic profiles. So we would need different data. And I totally second that we should collect these data and actually start looking into these things. The second question was about gender norms and endogeneity. And again, of course, you're totally right, because one's gender role attitudes can be influenced by one's life courses and vice versa. Now, we employed a little trick here. What we did is we measured gender norms, not of the individuals themselves, but of their environment. So we took a different survey that was collected in all these countries, and we just looked at the average norm that a person around that age, around that time, in the same country had, and just matched that average norm to the person. Because we argue that this is kind of the reference. This is what other people think about me, how I should behave. And that should be a reference for how I behave and how I feel and whether I get punished or rewarded according to my behavior. So we were trying to kind of circumvent that by not measuring the norms at the level of the person, but trying to measure norms for individuals that are quite similar to them, the peer group, so to speak.
Yeah, thank you very much, Kuriya, response. Thank you. Then, Kaku-sensei, please.
So we don't have a lot of time, so I just briefly answer your question. So to be honest, I have no answer to your question, like how many cells we need to feel sick. Because, at each single cell level, each cell feels their environment. For example, in kidney, a single cell can sense their surroundings. For example, the cell can sense the force, they like how the other cell push the itself or not. But so I don't have any good answer for your question. But I think in our body we enhance the signal to react to virus or those kind of things. So to be honest, I don't have a number, but I very small number of the virus or those kind of things could cause our sick.
Thank you very much, and thank you, my mucha buddhist.
Sorry for my very sudden, surprising questions, everyone.
Thank you very much. Now we want wrap up this session. Thank you very much for joining this session, and please clap your hands for the, to the speakers for the fascinating talks. Thank you.